We'll turn in your Bibles to Matthew 19. We'll continue, of course, our study of the Gospel of Matthew. We've been seeing for weeks and weeks and weeks that Matthew presents Jesus Christ as the King of the Jews. He has now left the northern part of Israel, where most of his ministry has been, and he's heading toward Jerusalem. He's going down basically the east side of the Jordan River. He's going to end up going to Jericho, across from Jericho into Jerusalem. So that's the plan. He is going so he can die on the cross to pay for our sins. That's the whole plan. And so this morning, as he's on the way, there's a powerful subject, a subject that a lot of people don't understand or maybe never understood, and it's the whole idea of rewards. And there's some confusion, so let me just raise some things. Some people have never even heard of rewards. When you say that one day you'll stand before Jesus and you'll be rewarded, some people say, I've never even heard that. Some people say that salvation is the reward, and they think that if you live good or try to do the right things, that that's how you get to go to heaven. And of course, that's wrong, but there's some people who are confused. And then the third is, some people actually think rewards are selfish, and you say, well, we don't serve God to get rewards, but Jesus told us to serve and run the race so you can get the prize. And then the fourth thing is that God rewards faithful believers. 2 Corinthians 5:10, we'll all stand before the rewarding stand of Christ to be rewarded for the things that we've done. So we're going to talk about it as we go through it. Jesus teaches this because Peter comes up and raises a question about, what about the future? You know, we all want to be rewarded. You think about this, you work for a month, or you work for 2 weeks, or you work for a week, or whatever, and at the end they're supposed to give you this paycheck, right? And you say, well, yeah, because I worked, and I expect to get, you know, I worked hard, so I expect that. Well, one day, you're going to stand before Jesus Christ, and if you served him now, you can expect that he would say, well done, good and faithful servant. So this morning, Jesus talks about this, gives a parable, and we're going to see the parable because the parable sometimes is misunderstood. We'll see it as we go through it. We discover that God's way of rewarding believers may be a little different than we thought it might be. So we'll be challenged as we go through this. There's a lot in this passage this morning. We'll go quickly, though. Well, I got my master's from Delta State University in 1972. Of course, later on, I went to Dallas Seminary and got my THM. But right after that, right after I graduated from Delta State, I really didn't know exactly what to do. I wanted to be a coach. I always wanted to coach football, and I always wanted to coach track. And even while I was at Delta State, I was a graduate assistant track coach. And so I graduated, and that's what I wanted to do. And yes, no call came to me from the Dallas Cowboys, and no call came to me from the Oklahoma State Cowboys. And so I had a twin sister living in Memphis, so I didn't move to Memphis. I just went to Memphis and stayed for a couple of weeks, and so I went to the Memphis public schools, and I applied for jobs. But while I was there, I got a call from my college track coach, and he said, hey, there's an opening at Eastside High School, which is in Cleveland, Mississippi, where Delta State is. He said, they've got an opening, and you can coach football and probably coach track and everything. So I came back, met with the superintendent, and we went over everything. He said, you'll coach track, you'll coach football, you'll do this. And I actually sat down and said, okay, that's what I want to do. And I signed the contract. And that's what we normally do, right? If you're going to take a job or something, a lot of times they'll sign the contract, do things like that, especially in the education end of it. Well, this morning, we're going to see a parable about a landowner, a vineyard owner, that he goes out and makes a contract with some people to go work for him. And then at the end of the day, he's going to, in a sense, give them their reward for their service for him, so to speak. But we're going to find that there's a twist to the story, and it's different than we might think. And we'll see how it fits together. So as we're going to this, remember, last couple of weeks, we've seen a lot of tough things. We saw the whole thing about divorce, and we saw discipleship, and we saw forgiveness and things like that. And then last week, we saw the rich young ruler who came to Jesus basically saying, now, how good do I have to be to get to heaven? I mean, you know, what good do I have to do? Following that whole issue, Peter raises a question. And Peter's question is, what's in it for us? What is in all this for us? And he raises that question. I can still remember the Field of Dreams. I love that movie. And Ray Kinsella is talking to Shoeless Joe Jackson, and Joe's talking to him, and Ray is going, look, I built the field. I knocked out the corn. I've done this. I've done everything you wanted me to do. And I've never once asked, what's in it for me? And Shoeless Joe says, what do you want, Ray? And he says, what's in it for me? And when you stand before Jesus Christ, you know what? What's in it for you? What's the plan? Peter says, we've left everything to serve you and to live for you. What's in it for us? Well, the truth is, every one of us who know Jesus Christ as Savior will stand before Jesus Christ to be rewarded. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, says we'll stand before him. For Romans chapter 14 says everyone will give an account of themselves. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says we'll all stand before the rewarding seat. It's called the judgment seat of Christ. It's a place of rewarding. And so as we look at this passage this morning, the issue of rewards comes up. So let me give you the outline. We're going to look at 27 through 30, which is Peter's question, basically is what's in it for us. And Jesus talks about rewards. And then to show a point, he gives this parable of the workers, of the man who hired him, went out to him, and then what happened at the end, and what's the explanation. So let's see how that fits together. So here's Peter. If you go to Matthew 19, look at verse 27. Peter's now going to raise the question to Jesus about what about us, because we actually are living for you and serving you. So look at verse 27. It says, then Peter said to him, said to Jesus, behold, we left everything and followed you. What then will be there for us? And Peter says it in verse 27. We left everything to follow you. Now, I want you to understand, we're not talking about salvation. Remember, salvation is a gift by faith alone. You have eternal life by trusting in Jesus. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. Faith alone in Christ alone, and you're saved forever. We're talking about discipleship. We're talking about serving Jesus Christ. We're talking about our lives counting for Christ. And this is discipleship, and this is where the whole reward things come in. And so Peter says, we left everything to follow you. Following is discipleship. And what will there be for us? So remember the distinction that salvation is a gift that costs us nothing. It comes by faith. It's free. It costs us nothing. We're saved and saved forever. But discipleship costs us our lives. It's where in Luke he says, take up your cross, die to yourself. In other words, say to the Lord, Lord, I give you my life. I want to live for you. I want to serve you. I want to do whatever you want me to do. Matthew chapter 10, verse 38, take up your cross and follow me. So Peter is asking about this discipleship thing. And Peter is saying, we've given up our lives to serve and follow you. So what's in it for us? And that could be a question to every one of this room that you'd say, listen, I trusted Christ as Savior and I have eternal life. I've also decided that I want to live for him and I want my life to count for him. What's in it for me? What does God tell me because I've decided to live for him and serve him? What does he have for me? What will he do? Well, I want you to see what Jesus says. Look at verse 28. And Jesus said to them, because even though Peter's raising the question, he's talking to all of the guys. He says, truly I say to you, that you who have followed me, that's not salvation, that's discipleship. You that have followed me, in the regeneration, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you shall also sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, Jesus says, listen, there's going to come a future time. He calls it the regeneration. I'll talk about it in just a minute. He says, there's going to come a time when the King, Jesus Christ, as the King of Kings, is going to sit on the throne in Jerusalem. And he says, you guys will sit on thrones judging the nation of Israel. And so he says that. It says in the regeneration. The regeneration is another name for the kingdom. Now let me remind you of this. You've seen the chart. This is where Jesus died on the cross, paid for sin. This is his first coming to the earth. He died and rose again, ascended back into heaven. We're now in what we call the church age. One of these days there's going to be a rapture. It could happen anytime. There's nothing that has to happen for the rapture to happen. The church will be taken off the face of the earth. There'll be a time period called the tribulation. It'll go for 7 years. And then Jesus will come a second time to the earth to set up a kingdom. This is the kingdom. This is the regeneration. He says to these 12 guys, when I come here and set up my kingdom and I sit on my throne in Jerusalem, you guys will have thrones ruling the nation of Israel. They were faithful men who served Jesus Christ. This is now toward the end of the ministry, and he says to them, you'll get to do it. You'll get to sit on thrones. That's places of authority and power. You understand that when you get to the kingdom, it's going to be on this earth, and it'll be 1,000 years, and then there'll be an eternal kingdom, which will be on a new heaven and a new earth, and every one of us, based on how you live now, we'll have places of responsibility. This is not salvation. Anyone who's ever trusted Christ, it's free gift. You trust Christ, you're saved forever. You'll be in the kingdom. But to serve in the kingdom, to rule in the kingdom, you have to serve him now. And he says to those guys, Peter says, what about us? We followed you. And Jesus says, listen, when I come as the king and set up my kingdom and rule, you'll have thrones. You'll have places of responsibility. And we go, wow, that is amazing. But then we say, well, okay, that's for them. That's for those guys. What about us? What about us? Look what the next verse says. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or farms for my name's sake. In other words, when you've left it and said, I want to live for Jesus Christ, I'm not living for other things, I'm living for Christ, for him will receive many times as much and will inherit eternal life. He says everyone, they shall receive in the future, because it's future aspect, rewards are in the future at the judgment seat of Christ, at the rewarding stand. And when he says, will receive many times as much, actually in the Greek it says 100-fold. He's like saying 100 times more than what you get down here, you'll get in the rewards. And he says, and will inherit the eternal life, which is the idea of having an eternal relationship with Jesus Christ. Realize, every one of us in this room, if you choose to live for Christ, now the salvation is, I just got to make it clear because some people get confused. Salvation is not living for Christ. Salvation is not trying to live a good life or do anything or giving you life. Salvation is a gift by faith alone in Christ alone. You're saved forever. As a child of God, as a saved person, if you choose to live for him, to say, I want my life to count for you. I want to go wherever you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want me to do. I want my life to count for you. He will reward you. One day when you stand before him, he's going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. Now, it's not for everybody. I mean, think about this. If you don't live for him now, if you just go through life, when you stand before Jesus Christ, 1 John chapter 2 says, you will be ashamed at his coming. So it is not guaranteed that believers will be rewarded. It is guaranteed that everyone who's trusted in Christ has eternal life. Have that the moment you believe. But rewards are different. He actually says for us, and listen, anyone who's followed me, who's left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or farms for my name's sake will be rewarded 100-fold in the future. Do you want to be rewarded when you stand before your Savior? Do you want to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant? You're going to have to live for him now. You have to say to him, Lord, I want my life to count for you. I want to live in such a way that I bring honor and glory to you. That's what I want. Now, he ends this with something that may surprise you. He ends it by saying, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. What is he talking about? What does he mean when he says last, first, first, last? And your first implication is, as Howard Hendricks used to say, he'd say sometimes at the judgment seat of Christ, there may be some famous people that somebody says, would you move out of the way? And somebody else comes up who nobody's ever heard of, who was a faithful servant of Jesus Christ. But I want to show you something. This passage ends with, but the who, when I say this passage, this chapter ends, but many who are first will be last and last will be first. Then he tells a parable. If you look at the very end of the parable, look down at verse 16, so the last shall be first and the first last. He's making a point. He's saying last first, first last. What is he talking about? Well, I want to show you something that you may have not thought of. How does God reward? It is not based on the, it is not on the basis of our time served or our abilities. It is not based on the time that we serve or our abilities. You know why? We don't all live the same time. We don't all have the same time. We don't have the same abilities. God doesn't reward us based, because what if you served God from age 20 to age 80? 60 years of service. What if you started serving at age 20 and you died at age 30? 10 years of service. You'd say, well, I only had 10 years. He had 60 years. God doesn't judge on time or ability. This is how he rewards faithfulness and his desires. We're going to see it as we go through the passage, as we go through the parable. So he says, many who are last will be first, many who are first will be last, and we're going to see what he means about that. So let's look at the parable. We'll go through it fairly quickly. Look at chapter 20. Look at verse 1. If you notice, he just flows right into it. If there wasn't a chapter division, he's still talking. He says, first will be last, last will be first, where there was this landowner. And he goes right to it. Look at chapter 20, verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. Now, he's saying the kingdom of heaven, what's it going to be like in the kingdom when we're all there and Jesus is on the throne and people are going to be serving and working and having great places of ministry? What's it going to be like? He says it's like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. Now, here's what his plan was. His plan was to go get people. Now, early in the morning, by the way, their days are a little bit different than ours. So the first hour, real early in the morning, is like 6 o'clock. The third hour would be 9 o'clock. o'clock. The 12th hour, the 6th hour would be 12 o'clock. The 9th hour would be 3 o'clock. The 11th hour would be 5 o'clock. That's how their clock went. So he's going out real early in the morning, and he needs some help. He needs some people to work in his vineyard. It must be the time to harvest, and so he needs some people. So he goes out, and it says he went out early to hire laborers. Now, most likely, there was a thing called the agora. It's a Greek word that has the idea of a marketplace, and that's where people would go. If a person wanted a job, they would get there most likely early in the morning and just be waiting. And business people or workers would come in, and they'd say, hey, any of you guys want to go help with the vineyard? Yes, okay, come on. And so this is what he does. And we're going to find that people came all day long looking for jobs, looking for work. And so he says, for the kingdom of heaven is like this landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. And so probably around 6 o'clock in the morning, he's there and he wants to get some people. Now look what he did. When he agreed with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. Now he agreed. He made a deal with them. A denarius was a day's wage. Normally, if you worked one day, you got a denarius. It was a coin. And that was about a day's wage. And so he says to them, would you guys want to work in my vineyard today, and I'll pay you a denarius? And they all went, yeah. So like that contract? Yes. Okay, we'll agree to work for a denarius. And that was pretty normal. And so he sent them into his vineyard. But then look what happened. He went out about the 3rd hour. That's now 9 o'clock in the morning. Other guys have been gone for 3 hours. He comes back. Apparently, he needs more help. And he went and he came back about the 3rd hour, and he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. So there's some other people. They're just standing around. So he goes up to him, and he says, you also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, I will give you. Now, he's not promising a day's wage. Why? Because they're not working a whole day. They're starting at 9 o'clock. Somebody else always starts at 6 o'clock. And so they went. So he said, I'll pay you what is what? Fair. See, they didn't agree on any price, but he said he would give them a fair amount. Now, they got to trust him that he's going to be fair. And so he says, go on up there and do that. And by the way, is God fair with you? He's, first of all, he's gracious, and then he's always fair. So watch what happens. So now you've got some people who started working at 6, and now you've got some people who started working at 9 in the morning. And then look what happened at verse 5. And again, he went out about the 6th hour, that's 12 o'clock, and the 9th hour, that's 3 o'clock, and he did the same thing. He hired more people. And then about the 11th hour, listen, it's 5 o'clock in the afternoon. How much longer are they going to work? About an hour. They usually work 6 to 6, okay? And about the 11th hour, he went out and he found others standing around. And he said to them, why have you been standing here idle all day long? And they said, well, because nobody hired us. And he says, you go into the vineyard too. And so they've all come and they've gone now in the vineyard. And so you've got people who worked 6 o'clock in the morning, from 9 o'clock in the morning, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and now 5 o'clock. So there's a lot of different times that people had worked. So from Matthew 20, verses 5 through 10, you got workers worked many different hours. The day is over. Some people worked 1 hour. Some people worked 3 hours. Some people worked 6 hours. Some people worked 9 hours. Some people worked 12 hours. Some people lived 10 years. Some people lived 20 years. Some people lived 30 years. Some people lived 50 years. Some people lived 60 years. Do you see where this is going? Watch what's going to happen. When the evening came, verse 8, the owner of the vineyard said to the foreman, call the laborers and pay their wages, beginning with the last group first. So they've called them in, and with the last group first. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, guess what they got? Each one got a denarius. Now, the landowner pays the workers. Those who worked only 1 hour got a day's wage. Now, if you're in line, and you're the guy that started working at 6, and you're back here, and you see them all lined up to get your denarius, and you hear that the guy that worked 1 hour got a denarius, you go, oh my gosh. And then the line's moving up, and you think, you know what, I worked all day for a denarius. Those guys worked 1 hour. He gave them a denarius. There's no telling how much he's going to give me. What do you think they got? It says that when the verse 9, when those hired about the 11th hour came, he gave them a denarius. When those hired first came, they thought they would receive more. But each one of them received a denarius. What? What did they agree to work for? But Daenerys, what if I said, will you work today for $100? And you said yes. And at the end of the day, say if a guy worked for 1 hour and I gave him $100, and you come up and you go, what do I get? Here's your $100 because that's what we agreed on. And you said, well, that guy only worked 1 hour and you gave him $100. I go, yeah, I know. And you go, that ain't right. Well, yes, it is. Watch. Because remember, this is not about your time or your abilities. It's about your what? Faithfulness. This is the key. Now watch. They thought, verse 10, those that were hired first, they thought they should receive more, but each one of them received a denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled at the landowner. And that the word, they kept on grumbling. They received the day's wage. That's exactly what they were supposed to get. But they said, hey, these last men have worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us. And we have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. So that doesn't really seem fair. They're saying they worked 1 hour, we worked a whole bunch. But remember, last shall be first shall be last. That means they're the same. Last first last. They're the same. They were not equal in time. Maybe not even in ability. But in what? Faithfulness. God rewards faithfulness. Now this is the key in your life. Because some of you are going to live to be 80 years old, 90 years old, and some of you are going to serve God for 50 and 60 and 70 years. And some of you are going to serve God for a shorter period of time. I had a young man that was in a Bible study that I had on Thursday mornings. He was in college. His last 2 years of college, we were in the Bible study together with me, with a bunch of men. We loved the guy. He was fantastic. He served in the church. He graduated. He got a job at Walt Disney World. And he was killed on the way to make it to Walt Disney World. He was faithful. He didn't get to serve very long, did he? Was he faithful? He was. When you stand before Jesus Christ, if you live 50 years, 40 years, 30 years, 70 years, 80 years, and you stand before him, is he going to say, sorry, they're going to get a lot more because they were here for 80 years and you were here for 20 years on the earth? That's not how it works. That's not what this parable is saying. This parable is saying, look, first last, last first. And look what he says to him. Verse 13, he said to the friend, I'm not doing you wrong. Didn't you agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go, for I wish to give this to the last man as the same as you. Is it not lawful for me to do to what I wish? Remember what we said? God judges on faithfulness and his desires. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with what is my own? Or is your eye envious because I am generous? See, the owner said, this is what I desire to do. And if you notice back again, verse 30, last first last, verse 16, so then shall the last be first and the first last. He's rewarding not on time. He's rewarding on faithfulness, not time or ability. Listen, some of you are so amazing with your gifts, your talents, and your abilities, and you serve God, and you serve God in ways that many of us, we can't even imagine how good you are and what God does with you, how he uses you. And there's some of you that's going to be serving God for 50 and 60 and 70 years. And there's some who aren't as gifted. They don't have the same talents. Maybe you have different spiritual gifts, but maybe not the same talents or abilities. I mean, I saw Mandy up there playing that thing. Listen, you could put me behind there for 27 years and I would never be able to do it. Okay? She can do that. I can't do that. And some people are going to live longer than others. Some people have different abilities than others. Some people, God's going to use some people in amazing ways. But the bottom line, it is required of stewards to be found what? Faithful. This is what it's about. This is what this parable is about. A lot of people are confused. Some people actually think, I say that this parable says everybody gets the same reward. No. This parable is showing faithfulness. Faithfulness. The last first last, they are the same when based on faithfulness. So here's a question for us. How do we stand? Are we faithful? Are we faithful to do what God wants us to do? Are we faithful to use our lives for his glory? If you're working at the university, if you're a professor or if you're a teacher or if you're on that campus somehow, are you faithful to stand for Christ on that campus? If you're a student, are you faithful to be examples? Stand strong for Jesus Christ on that campus. If you're a businessman or businesswoman, do you do your job to bring glory to Jesus Christ? Are you faithful that your life count for him? When no one is watching, Are we faithful? Are we moms and dads who are faithful to say we're going to base our home on and our marriage on the Word of God? We want to be salt and light in our neighborhoods. Are you and I faithful to do what He's called us to do? Because we don't have the same time and we don't have the same abilities. You remember the parable where He gave one guy 10, one guy 5, one guy something, you know, one or two? Well, the guy that got 10, he said, I earned 10 more. He said, great, got it. The guy that earned 5, but both of them got the same rewards that they both got to rule in the kingdom. Wow. We don't all have the same time on this earth. We don't all have the same abilities, but we can all be faithful with the responsibilities that God has given to us. Sometimes we think this way if you're in college. You know, I know, but one of these days, when I get out of school, when I don't have to study, when I get out of school, when I get like a real job and I don't have to, then I'll really start living for Christ. And there's some people who say, okay, well, you know, we're married, we got our kids. When our kids get into school, you know, like get in first grade, say, oh, you know, they're just babies, we have to change diapers, we have to do it. When we get going later on, then we'll get on fire. And then sometimes people say, well, you know, once our kids get into college and get moved, you know, then, and then all of a sudden you say, I think I'm too old to do anything. Some people never do. It's never too late. Never check out. For as long as you live on this earth, be faithful. This is the time that He's given to you. I could still hear Prof. Hendricks say, how many men and women over 50 are sliding home? They already quit. I'm just going to try to slide in. He says, run all the way. God's rewards are based on faithfulness. That's the equalizer. That's the last first last. Because moreover, brethren, is required of stewards to be found faithful. So let me give you two quick applications and then sort of a challenge. First application is God rewards as He desires. Think about this. He tells in this parable, don't I have the right to do without my stuff ever how I want to? And that's what God does. Aren't you glad He's great? Aren't you glad He loves? Aren't you glad that He's faithful? Aren't you glad that His love is beyond what we could ask or imagine? Aren't you glad that He's always fair and honest and true with us and He loves us beyond what we can imagine? Who else would you want to stand in front of? Our great Savior. God rewards based on faithfulness, not ability or time. It's not time. Some live to be 90. I read the biography of Jim Elliot. Some of you, maybe through Gates of Splendor, some other things. Some of you in this room don't even know who Jim Elliot is. You need to look him up and read about him. He didn't live but to be about 24 years old. He was on fire. He was a national wrestler at Wheaton College back in those days. When he graduated top of the class. They all said to him, Jim Elliot, you need to get a job. You could do anything. And he said, I'm going to South America, and I'm going to take the message of Jesus Christ to the Wahadani Indians, to the Alka Indians. And he and four others did that. And they did it for about a month, 2 months, 3 months. They got down on the ground. They met some of the people, and the people killed them. Jim Elliot didn't have many years. So some people lived to be 90. Jim Elliot lived in his 20s. God's not going to base it on time. And He's not going to base it on ability. Because you know what? When you're weak, that's when you're strong. When you depend on Him. And then finally, let us be faithful. This is the challenge. Let us be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. Who do we live for? Romans 12:1, offer our lives to Christ. Now remember, salvation didn't cost you anything. It's a gift. You're saved and saved forever. But being a disciple is going to cost you. And if you want to hear Him say, well done, then you're going to have to be a disciple and you're going to have to live for Him and you're going to have to let your life count for Him. And so, what will it be like when we stand before our Savior? I hope and pray for me and for you that we hear Him say, well done, good and faithful servant.